Thanks. Hi, I'm Patrick, and I don't want to do too much talking before we dig into the details. You see two company logos here, so just to explain where this comes from. I'm working with Center Device. It's a German startup, a cloud-based system for document storage and collaboration. And for that system, we are developing Elasticsearch-based search service for, well, almost 3 years now. In addition to that, we do consulting in the area of search technologies. So I'm taking a look at customer setups, troubleshooting, stuff like that. And what I'm going to present to you today is something like the combined, well, wisdom, if you will, that we've learned from all those setups that we have seen. I try to classify the different topics into do's and don'ts. And this is, of course, pretty subjective, but so if I couldn't come up with a good name for it, I excluded it from the talk. So that was the rule. So let's start right away. If this would be working. Okay. So one of the very important things to do when you're working with Elasticsearch is you should think hard about how you define your mapping. So the mapping is the Elasticsearch schema. So it tells you what exactly to do and how to the input JSON that you send to Elasticsearch. And it's tremendously important. So if not for many, then for one single reason. So if you want to make backwards incompatible changes to your mapping later on, you will need to re-index. And that can get pretty expensive. So what are the things that you can do regarding your mapping? Well, first off, you need to decide which fields do I want to analyze. By default, if you don't do anything at all, everything will be analyzed using standard analyzer. But for many fields, you maybe just don't want to do this, right? If you want to analyze, think about how. So there exists lots of analyzers that already do the job. If they don't do the exact job that you're looking for, don't be afraid to plug filters and tokenizers together yourself or to write custom filters and stuff like that. Don't be afraid. So furthermore, if you have analyzed some stuff, what do you want to store for the results? So you don't only get an inverted index pointing to document IDs. You also get information about term frequencies, positions, offsets, stuff that's relevant to provide additional services. So if you don't need that, you don't need to store it. You know, after all, it occupies space. But if you decide not to store something, then you need to be aware that maybe later on you cannot magically let it reappear, right? So we had this trouble in Center Device when in the beginning it was very clear that we would never support phrase queries. And so what did we do? We didn't store offsets. And then 1 year later, suddenly the requirement was there. And there's just not a way to get them back. So really think about requirements and don't optimize prematurely. So if I were now in the same situation again, I would include offsets, you know, just in case. Next topic is what to do with fields you don't need to analyze. So you probably know from Elasticsearch, there's a simple option called not analyzed, which means a field will only be indexed as it is. So using keyword analyzer behind the scenes, but not tokenized in any way. But you can also decide not to index a field at all. So you can just store it. And for nested JSON objects, so inner JSON objects to be precise, you can even tell Elasticsearch not to take a look at them at all. So just to store them with the JSON and return them if you get results, but not to analyze or check them in any way. So that's something that you should think about, otherwise you're just doing work that's not needed during indexing. The underscore all field. So by default, Elasticsearch stores everything you define or every field it gets as a copy in a field called underscore all. So basically, everything is analyzed and indexed twice. So that's nice to get started, but if you don't need the contents, if you don't need that for querying, disable it. So don't pay that price if you don't need it. Also, there's a kind of controversy about whether you should use the source or store separate fields. So Elasticsearch already stores the whole JSON you send to it by default in a field called underscore source. So if you do that, you probably don't need to store other fields explicitly again. You will store the stuff twice. So there are performance considerations why maybe for big sources you don't want to store it, and then you want to store only a few fields. But I've learned to accept that it's almost always preferable to store the source. It's useful for other things as well. For example, if you want to re-index, you have the original data already there. If you don't have the source, well, you need to access some other data source for re-indexing. So I've accepted that if I don't want to store the source, then I should better have some measurements to back this up. So further things to consider about mapping. So you see, I'm not going so much into details now because, well, you can find all those on the web in better sources than I could provide here. But this is to get you an overview of just, you know, what aspects of mapping there are. So by default, Elasticsearch uses dynamic mapping. So dynamic doesn't mean that there will be no mapping. Dynamic means once you send a field for it to the first time, it will automatically detect the mapping and then create a mapping. So dynamic mapping doesn't mean you won't end up with a long list of fields with their definitions. It just will be done automatically. Now, if you have a huge number of fields that you don't know, you will get a huge mapping, even with a dynamic mapping or dynamic templates. So in our case, we didn't really value that from the start, and so we got some trouble later on. So for center device, using our API, we allowed customers to just store any fields they might like and index the values for search. And just a few weeks later, we ended up with a mapping approaching 40 megabytes of space, so because they were utilizing it heavily. So now I would think twice if to provide dynamic mappings for such a use case. Index time versus query time solutions, that's also a very sometimes very important topic. So you can solve some problems at query time, for example, prefix queries. There are query capabilities for that. You can also solve it at index time, right? You can choose edge ngrams, for example, to generate tokens and then save some time during queries. So that's relevant stuff. You can solve some things during query time with scripts. Or you can index a field twice, maybe, to generate the representation that you can just sort on, for example, without needing to use a script in every query that you send. So that's important trade-offs. So I've come to the conclusion that it's better to address things on index time, but then you need to know it already when you create your mapping. So that's basically the challenge. And finally, there are various options how to copy or modify your data. I've just cited a few: multi-field, copy to, transform scripts. So if you want to modify your data somehow before analyzing it or before storing it, there are options. Try to learn about them and choose the one that's best for you. The final topic regarding mapping is relations. So you define a mapping for a type. And in Elasticsearch, you can also define relations between different types. So most prominently, something called a parent-child relation. When we started, we didn't know about this. We didn't check. We even didn't suspect a problem. So what we did is, if we had a document together with some metadata, access information, whatever, we indexed it as a single document to Elasticsearch. Now, there came the day when some customer of us reported that, you know, just selecting a document in the UI, assigning a label to it, froze the UI for 30 seconds. So we were stunned. We didn't expect that to happen. Now, it turned out behind the scenes, you know, just assigning a label, so making a little change to a document, means everything will be reanalyzed and restored again. So most of you know that probably. So Lucene doesn't know updates. It knows deletes and re-index. And for that particular document, there were like several 10 millions of full text characters. So just adding one tag to a single field like made it reanalyze all those several million characters again. So for that, 30 seconds was still pretty quick, but we couldn't continue to do it that way. So we decided to split up metadata parts and big full text parts into two documents, establish parent-child relation between them, and the problem was gone. So parent-child is still capable of supporting combined queries, so you don't need to be worried about that. Okay, that's about mapping. Now, a second thing you should definitely do is you should design for scale. So that can mean lots of different stuff. So let me show you an example what I mean. So this is how a typical big index looks like. So if you just create an index and don't do anything else. So you have one index, you have a certain number of shards, and you store your data somehow in there. So by default, it will just be distributed to the different shards based on document ID. Now, if you do a search query, you will have to search all those different shards, which at first maybe doesn't sound that bad. But in fact, distributed search queries are not, they are not giving you anything in terms of performance, right? You might think about parallelization and stuff, but in fact, a distributed search query means you have some guy, let's call it a client node, and this node is going to talk to all the others, so network round trips. It's going to hand over the search query to them. It will take some preliminary results, do some computations, and again ask those guys to return specific documents and finally send the result to the client. So those errors here, they don't mean that this is particularly performant or that you gain something from parallelization. You can gain something, but to my experience, rather often you lose something if you do distributed searches with a large number of shards. So saying if you can avoid distributed searches to many shards somehow, then it's a good idea to do it. So what's the second problem with that scenario? So you have a limited number of shards. So once you have chosen the number of shards for an index with Elasticsearch, you cannot change it anymore. It's fixed. So that's the second problem. If this index runs full, you will need to extend it somehow, and that means, well, maybe re-indexing. Now let's take a look at two scenarios where people try to avoid those problems. So one scenario is the typical ELK scenario, right? So that you know from Logstash, those daily Logstash indices. What we do there is we create new indexes for certain time frames. So in this example, we have one index per day. And now if you index your data like this, how do you solve those two problems? Well, first, regarding distributed search, if you have a query addressing only the last 2 days, then you only need to query those indexes here. You don't need to query back until November. So you save a lot here regarding distributed search or searching through data where you don't find any hits anyway. How does this strategy solve the problem with fixed number of shards, where you have a new index every day? And so if it turns out you need more shards, well, you can fix it the very next day when creating the next index. So that's very convenient for those scenarios where you just index data continuously, like, for example, log files. Let's take a look at another example. So a different category of scenarios is when you can partition your data somehow that certain parts of your data indexed is just accessed by certain users. So simplified here, let's say we have different users, could be groups of users, could be companies, whatever. So we have different users, and each of their users can only see their own data. So how can you approach a scenario like this, where you could go and say, okay, for every user, I declare my own index. So you can do that, but if you have lots of thousands of users, this won't scale anymore. So an index doesn't come for free. So what can you do? You can stick to a shared index with a fixed number of shards, And you can use routing. So that's the Elasticsearch term for it. So in more general terms, routing means you can redefine the shard key to use some string provided by yourself. So you could use routing and, for example, choose something like user ID as a shard key. So the result is all the data of user 1 will be stored in the same shard. So whenever user 1 sends a query, it will just hit one shard, and you don't have distributed search. So that's how you can address this problem if you have different users. How does this address the problem of fixed shards? Well, at first, it doesn't seem to provide any improvements here. We still have one index with a fixed number of shards. But so if one user grows big and reaches capacity, then you only need to evacuate that user into a different index. So you only need to touch one shard if it's user 1, migrate this to a new index, and the rest of the index data remains untouched. So to some extent, this also solves the fixed number of shards problem. So that were two solutions destined to two very specific scenarios. With your data, you might be in a completely different situation. So I'll just list a number of questions or aspects that you should ask yourself when you need to design an index for scale, so when data is flowing in continuously. So first, can you partition your documents or access to documents in some natural way and use it for index or shard definition? One caveat that you need to keep in mind, do you need to find documents by ID? So do you need to update documents, delete documents, or get documents? So if you remember the logstash example, where indices are created by timestamp, it's not convenient for updating documents, because given a document ID, you don't know where to look. So you would first need to query maybe some other database to get some timestamp for the document. Maybe you don't want that. So that's something to keep in mind. Do you need access by ID? You should know relevant features, so like routing, like aliases, which simplify index switching and re-indexing a lot, or multi-index search, that you can search across multiple indexes, just like you can search within a single index. So know about those features. I said it already, indices don't come for free. So you can't scale to tens of thousands of indices in your custom Elasticsearch setup. At some point, state and resources you need will likely get too big. And finally, well, I said something like distributed search is evil, but of course, you cannot avoid it. You do sharding for scaling out. So my recommendation is measure. So if you are thinking about choose this setup or another, then measure. So set those up in test systems and just measure if your queries are affected in some way. Okay, now let's move on to some stuff that you maybe shouldn't do. So, well, you can always say it both ways, but I declared it as a don't when I saw people doing it, and I didn't agree. So don't create more shards than you need. What do I mean by that? Well, you have reasons for shards, right? So more shards enable larger indices. You scale out. That's the idea. So larger in terms of space. But also, you scale some operations on individual documents, right? You scale indexing, you scale updates, you scale get by ID, and things like that. So that's why you have shards. You don't have them for fun. Those are the reasons why you have shards, to scale out. Shards don't come for free. So just like indices, shards don't come for free. So the recommendation stated by Elasticsearch in their guide is very correct. So if you design an index, you should try to measure how many shards you need. So try to do realistic measurements, some expectations on your data, and then define the appropriate number of shards. If you are unsure, then overallocate a little, but don't overallocate, by factor 3 or 4 or something like that, because everything will be distributed across those shards right from the start. So that's something you should take care of. So recently I had an example where a company was just doing the default setup for daily indexes. So something like Elk. They weren't using the whole Elk stack, but something similar. So the result was, after half a year, suddenly a single query just killed their system. So it was rejected all the time. You got out of memory. So all those things you don't want. So it turned out, where they stick to the recommended setup of one index per day, 5 shards per index. And so we're looking 200 days back. You can calculate for yourself. That makes, 1,000 or even more shards. So what happened is that each search query got split into 1,000 different search queries and handled by different threads in a pool, you know, in parallel and in succession. And intuitively, it's clear that this is not a good idea. So in particular, not because in their use case, all their data, even though it's data for half a year, still fitted in a single shard. And with a single shard, their system was stable, and this, you know, they didn't hit any problems anymore, and even got faster queries. So just saying, evaluate the number of shards, and don't blindly accept what's done by default. Something else about the cluster: don't treat all nodes as equal. So in an Elasticsearch cluster, you have various nodes, but those nodes can take different roles. Especially, you can have master nodes, data nodes, or something called client nodes. It's not a good idea in Elasticsearch cluster, at least not if you want to scale and be stable, to have master nodes being the same as your data nodes who handle queries, so those who can get out of memory or stuff like that. So it's really recommended to use dedicated master nodes. They can be smaller boxes, that's fine. So use dedicated master nodes. And if possible, also distinguish between data nodes and client nodes. So data nodes are those doing the actual queries, loading data from the index, reading the fields, reading the index. And client nodes are those where, you know, that guy who talks to them when a distributed search happens. So that's the client nodes. And they will also, you know, be ones who coordinate queries, who maybe forward requests to others. So distinguish between data nodes and those client nodes forwarding and aggregating requests. For client applications, you have a similar choice. So your client can talk to Elasticsearch using HTTP. It can talk to Elasticsearch using the transfer protocol, or it can even join the cluster as a client node. So those three cases are possible. In Java, it's, you know, HTTP client, transport client, or node client, basically. So if you have your application as a client node, it knows the cluster, it knows the sharding algorithm. So for sending indexing requests, it knows immediately which shard to address. So you save one hop compared to, for example, plain HTTP access, where one node might need to forward the request to the correct node. So we have come to use node client basically everywhere we can. That wasn't completely smart, because we also started using it for one-off stuff like batch jobs or integrity checking jobs that basically just do a single query and then shut down again. So whenever you use node clients, so your client joins, or your application joins the cluster as a node, the cluster will get informed about this. You will get certain information about the cluster, so it creates quite some overhead. So if you don't need this information about the cluster, if it's just a very quick and short interaction with the cluster, then better don't do that overhead, but use maybe transport client. So node client isn't always the best choice. On another note, so don't run wasteful queries. That's one thing I've seen pretty often. And by that, I don't mean expensive. There are situations where you need to run expensive queries, but just don't run wasteful queries that do more than they should. What do I mean by that? Only request as many hits as you need. Don't request twice as much just in case. Don't do that. Request as many as you need. Avoid deep pagination. So pagination is a very difficult thing, especially in a distributed setup with many shards. So for pagination, every shard needs to, where locally fulfill this query. So if you are on page 10 of 100 document pages, every shard in this distributed search will have to find out something about the first 1,000 documents, and all this information is sent back to this aggregator node. So deep pagination is a really difficult thing, and if you really don't have to, I wouldn't encourage your users on a UI to do it. Use scan and scroll to iterate if you don't need sorting. So don't iterate by using match all or some other query using pagination again. So use scan scroll. It's there to effectively and quickly iterate over the data if you don't need sorting. So sorting of those results. You can use filters and queries, of course. And finally, only query indices or shards that may actually contain hits. So we talked about this when talking about design. But if the design is there, then also use it. So I've seen logstash setups with daily indices, and still, queries just asking for the last 2 days were asking indices of the whole last year. So it happens. So if you can restrict those queries, then also do it when you write those queries. So on the other hand, what you should do is you should engineer queries, definitely. So I didn't want to say something like, write good queries or make efficient queries, but you should engineer them. So take them seriously. Now, what are examples of engineering queries? Where you measure performance. So don't guess. I've did that so many times, so believe me, it's not a good idea. I can tell you. Don't guess just because some blog says this is better than that. Don't do that, but measure the alternatives. Choose a production-like cluster and amounts and structure of data. Measure what's better. So that's the first rule to follow. Then use filters. So use filters wherever you can, when you don't need scoring, basically. Filters can be cached. And so the second time, usually, or after a few times you call a filter, it's cached, and it will be much, much faster than before. That being said, there's a ton of different rules and recommendations which filters are cached by default and which aren't, and in what circumstances. So I cannot say anything definite about this because those things are changing. So just to let you know that sometimes filters are cached, sometimes not. Sometimes compound filters are cached, sometimes not. Sometimes you will need to explicitly request that a filter is being cached. There are APIs to check whether it's being cached, and of course you will notice if it suddenly becomes faster. So be aware of filter caching and tune it. So that should be part of query optimization. And finally, you might have some rather heavyweight filters in your query. So consider reducing work for them as much as you can. You can do two things. So first, you can order the filters. So you have very selective or cheaper filters first. You reduce work for the others. And you can consider something like accelerator filters. So that's a difficult topic where you definitely need to measure. But let's say you have a filter asking for all documents in the last hour from now. So now is a pretty different thing to cache. So the time moves forward. So your filter, including now, will most likely not be cached. So every time you do that, you will need to evaluate that filter again for all relevant documents. But you can, for example, declare another filter, something like a time box, a small time box around the last hour, which is fixed. And a time box of, say, 2 hours, where you don't need to change it. You only need to change it 1 hour later. So you can define something like a time box filter, which will be cached. And only for those that pass this filter, you will need to evaluate the filter based on now. So that's just one example. But you should measure if accelerator filters bring an improvement for a use case or not. One thing you should do is you should care about field data. Right? So field data, let me just ask, who knows about field data? Please raise your hand. Okay, that's quite a few, but not the majority. So if you ever deal with Elasticsearch, care about field data. Okay, what is field data? Well, field data means whenever you need to access the original document's fields. So not the inverted index, but the actual fields. What do you need this for? Well, for sorting, for example, you want to do aggregations on those values. They are relevant for parent-child. And you might have scripts defined on them to do something with the original values. And field data is the biggest memory hog that you have in Elasticsearch. So especially in previous versions, it could easily lead to out-of-memory errors. So why that? So whenever you do one of those on a field, like sorting, those field data for all documents in the index or in the relevant charts will be loaded into memory, everything. And it will just stay there for all documents. So if you do sorting on different fields or aggregations, you quickly can get lots of field data on your Java heap. So that's not nice. By default, this area for storing field data is not limited. So it can easily, just make your heap get out of memory. So luckily, we now have something called circuit breakers. So out of memory will likely not happen in those cases, but your requests will get rejected, which means your server is still alive, but it doesn't help your requests. What you can do is you can limit the field data cache, say 40% of the heap, and well, once it gets too large, old field data is evicted. That's also an improvement, but still, if you have so much field data that it cycles all the way, nothing will get out of memory, but queries will get slow. So that's also not nice. So regarding field data, my opinion is that the only real solution you have is to switch to something called doc values. And if I'm informed correctly, this is to become default in the next major version of Elasticsearch for exactly that reason. So it's the only good solution for field data. You store field data on disk and rely on the file system cache, so the operating system's cache, to have the relevant pages in memory. And you move it from the Java heap to the file system cache, basically. So that will save you from sudden out-of-memory errors. Something you also should be is ready for indexing, for re-indexing. So you might need to change queries because they are expensive. You might suddenly enable field data because, well, it's consuming too much of your heap. There are several reasons why you would want to re-index. And so apart from those cases already mentioned, every incompatible change you do to a mapping, like redefining a field, analyzing it differently, all this will require re-indexing. When some index or chart reaches capacity limit, you will need to re-index. Or you have been too wasteful with charts and indices in the past, like having 1,000 now and only needing 2 or 3, then your solution is also to re-index. And you could spend hours and hours talking and thinking about re-indexing. I'll just give you some pointers what to think about. So how you want to re-index depends on various factors, and you really need to think hard about them. So that's why it's good to think about it right from the start. So how would I maybe re-index if I had to? So what's your data source? Do you have the source, or do you have a primary data store where you can read the data from? Do I need zero downtime during re-indexing, or can I do some part of it while the system is down? Do I use the update API? If you do, then re-indexing will be more difficult. Do I have deletes? If you do, then re-indexing will be a bit more difficult. Do you have something like a designated component, like a central queue, where everything that is being indexed runs through? If so, it will be a bit easier. So that's all questions you need to ask, leaving all the details aside now. So re-indexing is a difficult topic. If you can, use existing tooling for it. If you do it yourself, then use scan-scroll or the bulk API. So those are must-haves for re-indexing. Follow best practices, so use aliases from the start to be prepared if you need to re-index. Disable refresh during re-index, decrease number of replicas during re-indexing, so those are all known best practices that you will find in many articles. So reindexing is a really difficult topic. Okay, now we have some smaller ones to conclude the talk. Don't use the defaults. This is controversial, of course. You shouldn't just use them without checking. So at least not for some particular fields. So you need to change the cluster name. You need to make sure that your minimum masternode setting is set to quorum so that you don't have split brains in your system. You should ask yourself, is multicast discovery fine for me? Or better switch to unicast discovery based on a host list so that not some random node that somebody fires up suddenly joins your production cluster. We talked about number of shards and also replicas, so don't use the 5+1 default blindly, but think about it. Does it fit to your requirements? Refresh interval. By default, your search results become available, or your data becomes available for search after 1 second. So I've been in a situation where people want something like, well, even more real-time availability for search, then something lower is interesting. But there are many scenarios where you don't care, and then you don't need to have 1 second, you can also have 30 seconds. So this default is somewhere in the middle. It's good for testing, but often something different is what you want. Thread pool and cache configuration. So change it according to your needs. So on the other hand, what you should do is you should do monitoring of your system, right? So at the very least, you should monitor the cluster health. And well, nowadays it's not so important anymore, but if you're not running on 1.5 already, then it definitely makes sense to monitor for split brains. So ask each node in the cluster who that node thinks is master. And if they don't agree, then you have a big problem. So that's something that we are on 1.5 and we still have it in there, just in case. Monitor thread pools and caches. Do you have rejected executions? Do you have extra threads that need to cover large amounts of data? You can monitor that. So monitor garbage collection. Not only what Elasticsearch writes by default, but monitor the actual JVM output using the JVM flags. You'll get more details of it. And occasionally, so request slow log or hot threads API can point you to possible problems in your setup. Another quick one, follow the production recommendations. So that sounds trivial, but seriously, so I've seen many setups done without even Googling for production recommendations. So I don't mean to accuse people, you know, and I'm guilty myself. But a good start would be, if you're moving into production, so research and read something about production recommendations. For example, memory is important. Isolate Elasticsearch services as much as you can. Avoid swapping. Be aware of the usage of available processor settings, stuff like that. SSDs are recommended, as well as local storage. So there are tons more recommendations. So read through them before you move to production. Another one about production. Don't test in production. So I did that myself, and I regretted that. So everything you do, even, you know, just a quick, well, let's change that setting and then quickly restart the node. So that's something you shouldn't do in production, because maybe the node will take 20 minutes restarting or some big rebalancing will happen in your cluster. So don't test in production. Test in a testing environment. Test single node restarts, test rolling upgrades, node loss, and full cluster restarts. Do load tests, queries and indexing. How does your cluster react to high load? And finally, read the guide. So that's something I did after almost 2 years of using Elasticsearch. I thought I was an expert, but I noticed I'm not. And so read the guide. So the book, the definitive guide, it's a blast for understanding why things were done with Elasticsearch and why some recommendations are why they are. And read the API reference, not every detail, but just to know what's out there. You might need it later. So spend some time on this. days. It's well invested time. And that was the last one. So thanks for bearing with me. And I'm looking forward to any questions now or offline.